today I am talking about something you may not have heard of. You may have heard the name of it, but it's something that is definitely something we need to be aware of, and that is insulin resistance. And why it's got everything to do with menopause, weight gain, and aging. Hopefully I've got your attention now. Insulin resistance isn't something you're likely to be worried about on a day-to-day basis. You might know what it is, but if you're menopausal or you're over 40, it's definitely something that you might be experiencing without even knowing about it. So if you're gaining weight without changing your diet, if you're suffering from all kinds of menopausal symptoms, fatigue, brain fog, mood swings, anxiety, joint pain, insomnia, headaches, all that stuff. Yes, it can be due to fluctuating sex hormone levels, but you also need to be considering how your body is managing insulin. It's a very important hormone. As well as weight gain, insulin resistance, which I'm going to talk about in a second, it's an increased factor, risk factor for type 2 diabetes, heart disease, dementia, particularly Alzheimer's, cancer, and faster aging. So we do need to be aware of it and know how to avoid it. So what is insulin resistance? Well, insulin is a hormone that's released from your pancreas to manage your blood sugar. So when you eat food containing sugar or carbohydrates, because carbohydrates are just long sugars, then that sugar is absorbed into the blood, and insulin is released to mop up that sugar and take it to the cells. It needs to come out of that blood pretty quickly, because your blood cannot be holding too much sugar. So it takes the sugar out to your cells, of your liver and your muscles, to help move the glucose inside so that they can, those cells can then convert that glucose or that sugar to energy. The cells then, you know, take what they need, and the rest is stored away in your fat cells. So that is why it's often called the fat storing hormone, because often our cells are full and insulin's got too much glucose running around, so it stores it away as fat. Now, insulin resistance happens when your cells become less sensitive to insulin, or less receptive to insulin. So when insulin is knocking on the cell door, some of the cells are already full of sugar, so they don't need that extra sugar. So the insulin receptors on the cells kind of shut down, and they say, no, got enough, thank you, go away. That's what they're doing. And so that's the resistant form of insulin resistance. And that leads to just more insulin being produced by the pancreas to get rid of that, all that unwanted extra sugar. So your body goes into insulin overdrive. So too much insulin is being produced, and also you're going to get major blood sugar swings. You're going to be on that roller coaster going up and down with your blood sugar, which drains your energy, messes with your mood, gives you constant cravings, and makes your brain all foggy. And it's a massive stress on the body, resulting in more cortisol, now, which I'm coming on to next, because there is a big stress effect here with insulin. So even if you're on the best diet in the world, it's your blood sugar from your food is completely balanced and stable, and you're doing really well with your diet, you can still be at risk of insulin resistance, because stress alone can cause blood sugar surges and more insulin production. So cortisol's job is to put sugar into the blood for your fight or flight response, and it also prevents insulin from doing its job of getting that glucose inside the cells. So stress alone can be a factor in insulin resistance. So I often talk to women who say, I don't know what's wrong with me, I'm on the best diet in the world. And then we look at stress, and that's the missing piece of the jigsaw, because often we think, oh, you know, I'm fine, or I'm dealing with that, or I can't deal with it because it's out of my control. Whatever that situation, there's still a stress going on, and cortisol is doing a job there in imbalancing your blood sugar. Why are we more at risk of insulin resistance in menopause? Well, when we're going through perimenopause and menopause, we're more prone to this insulin resistance. It's due to a lot of different things going on. Metabolic changes relating to our adrenals, our stress response, our thyroid is not working as well as it should in a lot of cases. And of course, these sex hormone fluctuations, particularly estrogen. And increased difficulty, and that just results in increased difficulty in tolerating carbohydrates. We just can't handle carbs like we used to. And that can promote weight gain and this insulin response more than we would have done, should, you know, in our younger days when everything's nicely balanced. So we've got slower metabolism, we've got increased fat to muscle ratio in a lot of cases. We're slightly less active maybe than we used to, and there are lots of other factors as well. So what are we looking out for insulin resistance? What are kind of the symptoms? One of the things to look out for is a high waist to hip ratio. So when your waist is equal or bigger or larger than your hips. I mean, the standard measurement is 0.8, but you can pretty much go for, you know, equal, 1-to-1. So measure your hips, measure your waist. And that's an indication, if your waist is bigger than your hips, that, you know, you may be having some insulin resistance going on, or you're maybe on the way to that. High blood pressure, high cholesterol, high triglycerides, all indications, again, they go hand in hand with insulin resistance. Elevated HbA1c. Now, HbA1c, you can get tested at the doctors. It's high. It's glycated hemoglobin. It's your sticky hemoglobin, and it measures your diabetes risk over the last 3 months, how well you're controlling your blood sugar. So it's quite a good marker for things like pre-diabetes and your diabetes risk. When you're feeling tired, hangry, or dizzy when you don't eat, that can be a sign that you're on the blood sugar roller coaster, and you know you've got mismanaged blood sugar or insulin production. Excessive thirst or frequent urination, need to be watching out for. Constant sugar or carb cravings, family history of type 2 diabetes, that maybe you're genetically predisposed to this. And those are the main things. A mid-afternoon slump, 3 o'clock in the morning, insomnia, and other sort of signs that could be related to this as well. So just look out for some of these symptoms. And if you've got a few of those, you may need to just have your blood sugar checked, and just really, really watch your diet. And there are supplements as well that can help. Other health risks of too much insulin: it can interfere with ovulation, it can stimulate PCOS by stimulating more androgen production, it can increase inflammation, that's a big one, and because of that can lead to more serious conditions like type 2 diabetes, heart disease, cancer, and Alzheimer's, I've mentioned. It can also accelerate aging, because all that sugar in the blood causes something called glycation. It's pretty much sticky blood, and that can cause damage to your DNA and aging in general. So, you know, we don't want that either. So what do we do? How to balance your insulin response? Obviously, diet is absolutely key. You want to be really eating low GL diet as much as possible, limiting those refined carbs, the sugar. Alcohol is a big blood sugar disruptor as well. I'm sorry, but it is. You want to be eating more vegetables, protein, and healthy fats at each meal. And really, really focusing on those and just crowding out any sort of, you know, what I call quick burning carbohydrates. We want to be limiting snacking if we can, and sticking to really 2 or 3 big meals a day that have all those nutrients in them. And then, you know, overnight fasting can also be very helpful if your other hormones are balanced. Overnight fasting or intermittent fasting can be helpful to increase insulin sensitivity. Exercise is key as well. Make sure you're active, but you're not over-exercising, because that's just going to run up your cortisol. Strength training is absolutely key to maintain that muscle mass, because muscle helps to store glucose. So the more muscle you have, the more glucose you can store, and then the production of insulin is minimized. Stress management, absolutely key, because we know stress alone can impact your insulin production. So balancing your stress hormones, and you know, this is on every single video, so you know what to do by now. All the usual things, carving out 15, 20 minutes a day to yourself, unwinding, de-stressing, switching off, and really giving yourself that time to balance that cortisol production. Supplements can be very helpful for blood sugar management, particularly B vitamins, particularly B3, B6, and biotin. But I'd always get a B complex or a good multivitamin that has all your B's in it, so that you're balancing out those B vitamins. I wouldn't really be taking B vitamins on their own, because you need all of them anyway. Chromium has been shown to be really helpful with blood sugar balance. Magnesium is another one, which I always recommend anyway. Zinc. Alpha lipoic acid, curcumin, which is, we know, is the extract of turmeric, and berberine as well can be helpful, and vitamin D has an important role, as it does seem to have in everything we do, but it definitely has a role in insulin metabolism. So All of those supplements can be helpful, but again, please don't take anything. And if you're on a medication, you want to be checked first and go check with your doctor. Testing can be helpful. You want to be starting with your HbA1c levels. Most doctors will do this for you to look at your diabetes risk. Other tests might include things like fasting insulin or glucose tolerance testing. Or if you want to track your blood sugar levels, if you're kind of serious about this, you can now track them with there's a great app and a sensor that you can try. I think they do a 14-day free trial as well through Freestyle Libre, I think. I'm going to put the link in my blog. It's something that it's a sensor that you attach to yourself, and it's really cool. And if you want to have a comprehensive look at all your hormones, do contact us for more information. Hope that was helpful. I'll see you next time.